All right.
So you all have your exams and everything back. It's pretty straightforward. I appreciate all the hard work. It'll get easier, you know, after you've been through it a couple times. And again, the packages will just get better and better. And then what I do is I usually submit those, or samples of it, to the dean and the chair and those guys, so they know what we're doing. Okay? We know the level in which we're operating. So the course website, I'll put up the videos. Homework 2 is already in the syllabus. Midterm exams are already posted. Memo 1 and 2, give me your memos, start coming to me, you know, even more. If you haven't picked up your, I think everybody's already picked up their deliverables, which is great. The second one is due on April 27th. I think that gives you over a month to be able to do it. So if you have any problems with anything, come see me, okay, and I'm going to help you out. If you have any problems on the take-home test questions or the homework questions, come see me. I'll work with you through them, but do not get bogged down. Do not get stuck on them. The key to a good test-taking is moving through the material, answering the stuff that's easy and the stuff you can answer very quickly, and then circle back, attempt them again, and if you just can't do it, then come see me. Okay? That's basically the test strategy. So everything's due, again, next Thursday. So you got a week to basically just fine-tune and just get everything. And I think everybody, except for one person who didn't come back, everybody's operating at a very good level. So you're all going to get, like, really good grades. Because you put through the time and the process and you're doing everything, you know, in the right way. And I really appreciate it. So make sure that you correct and resubmit the in-class exam. If I asked you to add more to it, I do have that, you know, test review lecture, you know, that we spent 2 hours, went through everything. You can fast forward to the section where you need more help, and boom, I'll walk you through it in like 20 minutes, okay? The take-home exam, again, just burn through it, show the corrections, same thing with the homework, and then give those back to me. Because you'll remember, you know, the processes more, if you're doing the corrections yourself, because you'll be able to see it and you're reviewing everything again. So you just reinforcement, that's how you learn this stuff, is just through reinforcement, and then boom, someday it's like, okay, I got it. It's like, wow, I totally get it now. And then the midterm is gonna be over April 25th and 27th. Again, start bringing me those memos, and when you hand in the memos, don't give me one memo, okay? Give me all the memos. So 2 is due, give me 1 and 2. 3 is due, give me 1, 2, and 3. Is 4 is due, give me 1, 2, 3, and 4. So I'm constantly editing and perfecting and showing you formatting and editing and economic logic and evaluation. So I'm training you on a one-on-one basis. Because those memos are really, really important, really important. And then what we'll do next Tuesday is I want to show the Inside Job, which is a documentary award-winning on really the corruption and the unethical and immoral behavior in the finance industry leading up to the financial crisis. It's a really good documentary, and I'll also have a little discussion on some of the moral and ethical decisions that I've had to make throughout my career, let you know what the scenario was and how I approached it, because you're definitely going to confront this stuff, and you're going to have to make decisions. And it's not easy, okay? So we'll kind of do a little ethics laboratory on Tuesday. And then today what I'll do is I'll do chapter 11. We'll kind of get through that. We'll talk about cash flows, building cash flow statements, and then using those free cash flow statements to be able to conduct the capital budgets for investment decision making. Before we do that, how about giving me some market updates really quickly? Jump on your computers, give me the Dow, up or down, by how much and why. Really quickly, give me Dow, give me oil.
Dow's up 20,000.
Okay, how much is it up or down?
It's up by like 50 points.
Okay, any reasons why it's up other than maybe a dead cat bounce ever after a major correction that it had over the last 2 days? I mean, the market was down, what, last week for the first time since October? Market's been in an upward scream since Trump was elected. At some point, it's gonna have to correct. So are there any earnings or interest rates or anything out there that's moving the market other than a sell-off? Because when the market corrects, people get in there and they buy Procter & Gamble and Johnson & Johnson and buy really good companies after they've corrected. Okay, any reasons?
Nike's earnings were better than expected.
Okay, that might signal to the marketplace that there's better earnings expectations coming. And as we know, earnings and earnings cash flow expectations are gonna drive stock prices up using the perpetuity or the Gordon growth model. Okay, excellent. What about oil? Where's oil trading? You wanna be on your computers.
47.70.
Will you poke him in the side? Are you looking at oil?
Yeah, right.
Yep, okay. Are you looking at oil? In the back, way in the back. Yeah, okay. So where's oil trading? 47, okay. And when was it last at 55? When was it last trading at 55? Would 55 be the resistance? If you go back and you look at the chart, does it look like it's bouncing off the 55? Is 55 the resistance?
Yeah.
Yep. And then what looks like the support? What's it bouncing off of? What's the support?
Around 48.
48, yeah. I think it dipped below that to 42 for a little bit. So it's in a trading range, right? Anything out there in regards to news that's driving the prices down? Go for it. Just say it.
OPEC is not meeting its cut target.
Okay, perfect. That's a great one. Any others? For those of you who are doing
storage.
The... What is it?
It's like too much storage.
Too much inventory.
Too much inventory.
Yeah, so we're already maxed out on inventory. So everything's flowing right into the market. Anything else? Anybody have a comment on domestic production? Are we exporting oil? Due to what?
Fracking.
What is it?
Fracking.
Because of fracking. Okay. So you want to look at rig counts. Okay. So start monitoring rig counts. And what about gold? Where's gold trading on a per ounce basis? Where's it been trading? What range has it been trading around?
1,244.
Yeah, around 1,200. Any movement? Over the last 24 hours, would the terrorist attacks in London have anything to do with gold?
Yeah.
If people are scared, do they go into gold? If they're scared, do they buy gold?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if there's more terrorist attacks in anticipation, would people be going into gold?
Yeah.
They would. Okay. So think about that. It's either fear or inflation that really drives gold. Okay, where is the 10-year treasury yield right now?
2.42.
What is it?
2.42.
Now, is that up or down?
Up by a little.
It's up a little bit. Has it been trending down or trending up? I think that it was trending up in anticipation of the Fed's announcement of rising interest rates, but actually the 10-year treasury has been drifting down, right? So people are buying into the treasury and driving down the yields, right? Either due to fear, need for liquidity, or lower inflation expectations based off of the Fisher equation, okay? So start thinking about the models and start pumping in the information into your brain and figuring out why these prices are moving, okay? That's what the whole supply-demand analysis and everything was that we went through in the exam. And then give me the dollar to the pound and dollar to the euro.
Dollar to the euro is 1.07.
1.07?
Okay.
And is it up or down?
Down.
It's down? Okay, so basically the dollar's appreciated against the euro because it's costing us less, right? Okay, and the dollar to the pound is really important because of the terrorist attacks. So what's happened to the dollar to the pound exchange rate over the last 24 hours?
It's risen.
Yeah, give me the level, and then tell me if the dollar to the pound exchange rate is up or down. And then you can figure out if the currency is appreciated or depreciated. So is the dollar to the pound exchange rate, what has it done over the last 24 hours? And the terrorist attacks must have had something to do to it. It must have had an impact. Is that totally logical that people were selling pounds and buying dollars after the terrorist attack? If there's going to be more terrorist attacks in London and in the UK, is that going to disrupt the economy?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. And are people going to buy or sell pounds?
Sell.
You're going to sell pounds, and that's going to cause the pound to appreciate and the dollar to excellent. Nice job, you guys. Okay. So this is the game. This is how it's played. And if you get, if you're getting this, and you can get it, this is how the traders think. This is how CFOs and CEOs and politicians and everybody think. They all have this stuff in their head. Okay, so let's quickly go through chapter 11. We're going to talk about incremental cash flows, rules in calculating the incremental cash flows, because this is all about being able to calculate the net present values of the internal rates of return based on pro forma cash flow statements. So they're income statements that you are basically going to project and forecast out over 3, 5, maybe 10 years to then be able to discount those cash flows back to the present to make investment decisions. So this part of the class, which I don't really spend probably enough time on, is really going through and cranking through and forecasting out each individual line item in the cash flow statement. Okay, and that's what you would do if you were a financial analyst, or a CFO, or a controller, or an investment banker, or a mortgage banker, or a personal loan lender. I mean, you're going through this. You're always building cash flow statements and projecting into the future and trying to make investment decisions. So getting to the cash flow statements is really important. Understanding variable revenue, variable cost, marginal revenue, marginal cost, profit margins. And when you're doing these cash flow statements and these investment analyses, you're not including sunk costs and you're not including overhead allocations, which is firm-wide because we're trying to make decisions at the project level. So we try to avoid some of the distortions that may be imposed upon us by the firm. Okay. We'll look at operating expenses a little bit. Equivalent annual cost, this is really important because it allows you to be able to make investment decisions based on two projects with different lives. This may have a 10-year life, this may have a 5-year life. This may be a piece of equipment that has a 5-year life, and our current piece of equipment has 3 years remaining on its life. We can then make investment decisions based on different life, or different maturity, or different life assets. We'll look at replacement decisions, opportunity costs, and this is really important. I don't think the book does a very good job, or most firms don't do a really good job, of investment is exit strategies. How do you replace? How do you renew? How do you exit? How do you make decisions on selling the division, the product line, the company? It should be rules-based. It should be quantitative. It should not be based on gut feel. It should be something that's mapped out, and that if the criteria is met to exit, then this firm should make the decision to get out. But a lot of firms don't have rules-based exit strategies. They use gut feel, because they're, in my view, they're somewhat lazy. Okay? But it's not best practice. So when you're calculating the cash flows or the profit, you want to look at the net cash flows. You're looking at selling prices per unit, the cost per unit, profit per unit, fixed or sunk costs. You're avoiding the fixed and sunk costs. You're avoiding the overhead allocations, because that's coming from the firm level. And you want to make sure that you're getting an annual return on your per unit profits. Okay, so you always have to have that profit margin. In the capital budgeting process, your focus really is on the net present value estimates based on the future cash flows. There's problems with internal rates of return if the cash flows change over the time period, but the investment decisions are usually made based on the net present value. And we're going to go through an actual live example from today. The incremental cash flow, again, I'm using it for the NPV calculations. It's the amount of unrestricted cash flows, or the free cash flow. So the free cash flow calculation, we're going to walk through it. This is at the firm level. But when you're evaluating a firm to acquire, you usually don't have a lot of this information at the firm level, so you end up using EBITDA as a proxy for the free cash flow. again, this is just based on my experience in analyzing and looking at, you know, startup companies. So the free cash is distributed. The reason why it's important is the free cash flow that's available to pay off the debtors, you know, for the bondholders, and to pay dividends to the stockholders, or to retain that cash flow to then plow back into the firm to then grow the firm using retained earnings, which is the cheapest source of capital. What you're really looking for is the incremental contribution of the project to the cash flow of the firm. Actually, this really should be firm. So what is the cash flow with the project? What is the cash flow without the project? So what's the contribution of the cash flow to the overall cash flow? And obviously, it's got to be positive. Project-related expenditures, when you're looking at a project, just look at the expenditures that are related to the project. You're not using the overhead allocations of the expenditures that are being imposed upon you by the firm. You're trying to isolate the cost and the benefits associated with that project. However, I'll talk a little bit later that if you do the project and it generates revenue in another division or area of the company, those benefits need to be thrown in to our cash flows for the project. Because it is generating. Working capital, changes in inventory, accounts receivable, long-term assets, capital expenditures also need to be taken into consideration. And then the free cash flow calculation at the firm level is going to be the revenues minus the operating expenses minus the depreciation and amortization. And then one minus the tax rate. Because you want to lower the depreciation and amortization lowers the taxable income. Then you want to add back the depreciation and amortization because it's a non-cash charge. It's basically, it's just accounting. So you want to add that back because that is cash. And you want to take out capital expenditures in addition to working capital. Now these three here could distort the free cash. What's your depreciation allowance? What's your depreciation method? Capital expenditures. Do you have a big project in one period that's going to have a major impact on the cash flows? Do you smooth it out over time? That's going to have an impact. And then additions to working capital. How are you financing? And I'll go through working capital in a minute. That's why a lot of firms use EBITDA as opposed to free cash. So the income statement, these are basically the line items, and then you're going to forecast out over a 3-year or 5-year or 10-year period the pro forma income statement. It's called a pro forma income statement, which is a projected income statement that you're going to use to then be able to discount back the cash flows to derive the present value, net present value, and an internal rate of return to make the investment decision. So the line items in the income statement is revenue minus cash, operating expenses, EBITDA, minus depreciation and amortization, which gives you operating profit, which is EBIT. Take out the tax shield component, you get net operating profit after taxes, add back depreciation and amortization, it gives you cash flows from operations, take out the capital expenditures, take out the additions to working capital is going to give you the free cash. So we have an example here where we have revenues of $50,000, operating expenses of $30,000, depreciation of $10,000 per year over 3 years, a marginal tax rate of 35%, capex of $3,000 per year. So the free cash flow is going to be the $50,000 minus the operating expenses minus the depreciation, one minus the tax rate, add back the depreciation, minus the capital expenditures, and there's no additions to working capital in this example. So you get free cash flow of $13,500, or this could be $13,500,000. And again, you're probably going to be working for companies that are going to be in the millions as opposed to the thousands. Okay? So to calculate the cash flow, project, incremental cash flows, operations, cash flow remaining after the expenses and taxes, subtract the capital expenditures, some to track out the additions, the way additions to working capital, and you're going to get the free cash flow after tax, cash flow over the expenditures. The standalone principle basically states that when you're looking at projects, they're looked at on a mutually exclusive basis. You're on a standalone basis. You're looking at the incremental cash flows from the operations. The incremental not operating profits after tax for the NOPAT. And again, you're adding back the depreciation. You're going to add the depreciation amortization back to the NOPAT to get the cash flows from operations. Deduct the depreciation amortization, and again, it depends on how these are treated. And again, they're under GAAP, which we'll talk about. These aren't taxes, and I'll talk about after-tax effects that you want to run. You want to run it pre-tax and after-tax, okay, to get to the cash flows. Accounting earnings are going to be distorted by the accounting methods. That's why we want to use free cash flow and not use accounting earnings, because they're unreliable. Also, you want to take a look at the Excel spreadsheets. I'll send these to you too and make those available. You should have already hopefully downloaded the Excel spreadsheets that I have available to you on the website. And I'll walk you through some of them later, but they'll be really valuable for you to have at some point, because you may be asked to do some of this stuff and you don't want to recreate the programming involved with the Excel. You want to have those Excel sheets already pre-programmed and ready to go. Okay? So you might have to do just some modifications on the backgrounds. We want to use only estimated cash flows. No allowances for overhead related to the project. We want to look at the impact of the projected cash flows over on other product lines. So again, like I said, if we introduce this project and it creates additional revenue for another product line because it's complementary, or you're cross-selling, unless you want to include those benefits in our cash flows and any additional expenses. So it should be the net cash flows. Should be included. Include all opportunity costs too. So there may be, if we do this project, it's going to take from this project, and we're going to lose X amount over here because we didn't do this project. There should be some factor that's taken in from the box, not doing it on a net basis and not doing this other project. And again, ignore some costs. They've already been incurred, they're already committed, and they shouldn't influence our project. It should be standalone, mutually exclusive. Incremental pre-tax cash flows are the only thing that matters if determined in an after-tax cash flow. There are nominal and real cash flows. I've never seen, in my 25 years, I've never seen anybody do nominal cash flow. I mean, sorry, a real cash flow analysis, because it's more complex. I got to estimate the nominal cash flows. I got to discount those cash flows back by the inflation rate to get the real cash flows. Then I got to take the discount rate, the nominal discount rate, and adjust that for inflation too. So I have to go through three steps to get to the same place if I just did nominal cash flows. So I've never seen it. You're going to use nominal cash flows. And the thing to understand too about nominal cash flows with a nominal discount rate or expected return or cost of capital is the risk-free rate is embedded in the cost of capital and the expected return. Do you know the equation calculate the risk-free rate? What equation would you use to calculate the risk-free rate? Okay, another test question. Are the yields to maturity along the yield curve risk-free rates? Okay, another question. Are U.S. Treasury yields risk-free rates? Okay, so let's go through the answers and we need to memorize these. Okay, so the equation for the risk-free rate is the nominal interest rate using the Fisher equation. Now, does the Fisher equation include inflation expectations? Does the Fisher equation include inflation expectations? Yes. So if the risk-free rate, which includes inflation expectations, is the base rate to building the expected return and the cost of capital, are inflation expectations already embedded in the discount rate? Yes or no? Yes. You want to verbalize this. You want to follow along and verbalize it so that you memorize it. And when you don't verbalize it, you're not going to memorize it. Okay? So, are inflation expectations already embedded in the risk-free rate? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. So that means that you can use the nominal discount rate or the nominal expected return of the nominal cost of capital to discount the nominal cash flows to get the net present value. Okay? So it's all in the nominal. It's all in the, you all use nominal dollars. Okay? So here's my crude fishery equation. Okay? But the real risk-free rate would be calculated by using 1 plus the change in the price level, which is the expected inflation rate, times 1 plus the real rate of return, minus 1, is going to give you the nominal interest rate, or the risk-free rate, or the base rate. But they're all the same thing. Okay? So what you're going to find out is in finance, like any other language or any other discipline, there's going to be multiple definitions for the same thing. And again, what you're going to learn every time, just like in marketing or advertising or ops or entrepreneurship or in, you know, digital media, you're going to be learning the language and you're going to be able to communicate with, with people in very precise language. Okay. So it just takes practice. So an example of a nominal and a real cash flow example is we'll start with the nominal cash flow example. So we have an investment of $50,000, this could be $50 million. The free cash flow is $20,000 per year, and the cost of capital or the expected return or the discount rate is 15%. So minus 50 is the initial outlay. We have 20,000, 20,000, 20,000, divided by 1.15 to the 1, to the 2, to the 3, to the 4. And we're going to get the present value of those cash flows, and we're going to subtract out the initial cost to get the net present value. What this example doesn't show is there's no residual value or terminal value. So if I'm going to buy a business or a piece of real estate or even a piece of equipment, I'm probably going to have some terminal value or enterprise value or salvage value at the end. So this is a very simplistic example that is not really reality. Then the nominal approach, I mean the real approach, is you would go back and discount these cash flows first at the inflation rate. So in this case, the inflation rate is 5%. So we're going to divide the $20,000 in free cash flows by 1.05 per year to get the real cash flows. Then what we're going to do is we're going to take the discount rate, the 1.15, divided by the inflation rate, 1.05, to get the real rate, which is 9.25%. Then you're going to divide the real cash flows by 1.0952 to the 1, the 2, the 3, the 4, to get the net present value. Doing the real calculations takes 3 steps. Doing the nominal takes 1 step, okay? But it gives you exactly the same net present value. So it's like, why even do it? It gives you the exact same net present value. So maybe you would do it if you had, if you were forecasting different inflation rates over time, and usually you don't vary the discount rate, maybe. But again, they're the same, so why would you use real? You wouldn't, you'd use nominal. We can have a little discussion now on taxes. Taxes, both personal and corporate taxes, are progressive here in the States. And we'll see what happens. I mean, once healthcare is, whatever happens to healthcare policy right now, they decided to come out of the chute and attack, go after healthcare. But they're on their list, their second to-do list, is personal incorporating their taxes. So we'll see how they modify the progressive aspects associated with the corporate income tax. And I know they want to lower the corporate income tax from 35%. I don't know if they're going to lower the maximum marginal personal income tax of 39.6%, and this doesn't even include alternative minimum tax. So we'll see what happens with the tax legislation. I usually want to run, when you're doing the investments, using the GAAP accounting rule, which allows you to depreciate on a straight line basis. But again, your tax savings can be huge when you run it from a tax standpoint, because you might have accelerated cost recovery systems, which means that you have larger depreciation allowances, so you have more cash in your pocket in the first 3 to 5 years of the project. So you usually want to run the IRRs using the straight line GAAP approach, but also take into consideration accelerated cost recovery systems, because they're just putting money in your pocket. And this becomes extremely important when you go into alternative renewable projects. You go work for a solar company or a geothermal or a biogas company, because we get accelerated depreciation. We may actually even get tax credits and subsidies that can be added to the cash flows. So again, you have to really look at the tax component too. And then in the last year of the free cash flow calculation, you have to look at additions to working capital. So changes in cash equivalents, changes in accounts receivable, changes in inventory, changes in accounts payable. So again, these could be distorted too in your cash flows. That's why I think EBITDA is a good measure. So the net present value analysis uses projected, forecasted cash flows over the holding period. And again, holding periods are going to be determined by the type of investment that you're making and really the type of company that you're going to work for. Some companies are opportunistic and value add. We're going to buy this company, we're going to turn it around in a year or two, and then we're going to spin it off. We're going to buy this company, we're going to turn it around, we're going to stabilize it, we're going to exploit it, and then we're going to sell it, or we're going to take it public. So different companies have different holding periods. The terminal value at the end of the cash flow, if we're trying to value a firm, there's going to be some residual or some terminal value, there's going to be some sales value at the end of the period. And what's really important, and you need to write these notes down. Because I'm telling you the nuances here, all right? So first, this is really important to understand. It's the cash flows in the early periods of the pro forma that have the largest impact on the present value, the net present value, and the internal rate of return. So the faster the growth rates in the cash flow in the earlier period, the larger the contribution will be to the present value, the net present value, and the internal rate of return. So when you're making projections in that 1 to 3 year time period, you have to be extremely accurate, because if you make mistakes, it could blow the project, okay? The other dirty little secret is that you have to understand that investment bankers, corporate real estate, corporate finance executives that are actually involved in doing all of this analysis, if they work internal to the firm and they get paid and compensated for bringing in deals and presenting deals and getting deals approved, they are going to have an incentive to make the growth rates in the earlier periods look better, and they're going to make the terminal value on the back end be higher. So they vary and they can juice and manipulate present values, net present values, and internal rates of return and break even by inflating the terminal value on the back end of the pro forma. And I'll walk you through an application today. So what we have to be able to do, again, is to forecast the incremental cash flows from operations, net revenue, take out the operating expenses, depreciation, amortization, and take those into consideration. The equivalent annual cost approach, this is what you're going to use when you have two projects of different lengths, okay, to be able to make the decision. And the way that you do it, in this case, I have two projects. The cost of capital, or the expected rate of return, is 10% in both, because that's determined at the firm level. I got two projects. One that's going to cost us $250 million, the other is going to cost us $360 million. We're going to turn around this one in 2 years. We're going to turn around this one in 3 years. So what you do is you take 1.01 squared, 1.01 squared minus 1, 1.01 to the third, 1.01 to the third minus 1. So it's this piece right here that you use to be able to calculate the factor that you're going to multiply against to get the equivalent annual cost. So the in this case, the equivalent annual cost is negative 44.05. In this case, it's negative 44.76. The cost is less for this compared to this, so you're going to pick project A. Lastly, the exit strategies. Okay, so here's the key. When you're investing in these projects, you're going to be monitoring the net present value. And what you want to do is calculate the net present value over time, and you're going to see that there's going to be growth rates in the net present value. The net present value is going to increase on a percentage basis, and then it's going to start to deteriorate. So what the point in which the growth rate in the net present value reaches your discount rate or your expected return, that's the point in which you sell. Okay. So it's going to be the change in the NPV, percentage change equals your expected return, weighted average cost of capital, to your discount rate. This is the point in which you're going to sell. And companies forecast net present value growth rates and project out when they should sell. So if you, Warren Buffett's probably not a good example because he likes to buy and hold, but some of these private equity firms, or real estate firms, what they'll do is they'll buy these assets, they'll be tracking the change in the net present value, they'll project out when the net present value is going to hit the discount rate, and they start to prepare for the acquisition and sale of the asset prior to hitting it. So they can, sometimes these billion-dollar projects take years to prep to get ready to sell. So that's the exit. And then lastly, it should be rules-based exit strategies, where basically you determine if these factors basically happen, check, 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 it's time to sell the company, it's time to sell off the asset. This becomes an automatic, unemotional, quantitative, metric-oriented, and not emotional. And what you'll see, what I've heard, is a lot of these venture capital firms, the top venture capital firms, do not use the rules-based exit strategies. There's a lot of senior people there. They don't want to be restricted by these rules. They get together in these committees and they basically vote and go around the table and say, what do you feel? How do you feel? And they probably have made a lot of mistakes, but the economics in those firms are so huge that even if they make mistakes, they still make a huge amount of money. So it's immaterial for them. It's not, they should be adhering to best practices, but you may be in a company, like I've been in companies, where you cannot afford to make any mistakes. You gotta be able to buy these assets right, you gotta perform, and then you gotta be able to exit those assets just as precisely as you enter the assets. Because if you make mistakes, it can cost more money. So what I did also, could you see if there's any extra copies of these? Around? what I did, and I will provide these to you, and it's already posted. I think there's some extra copies over there. This is basically the midterm. So again, on the midterm, I'll ask you about zero negative interest rate policy on asset prices. I'll ask you about yield curves, again, because yield curves are the risk-free rate, and the base rate for expected returns, discount rates, that all flows through to this stuff. The modern portfolio theory, really important to understand that it, when you add alternatives to the stock bond portfolio, since there's low, no negative correlations with the returns, it's going to bow out the efficient frontier. And the efficient frontier bows out with the application of the derivatives also. So really important to understand that. Understanding the basic structure of the intrinsic valuation theory. And then we have three cases. Okay. We have a business investment banking. You should probably pull up the, if you can, pull up the in-class exam right now off the website. So you can follow through and we can work this one out and you'll have the data in front of you. And it should be right at the top, isn't it? Are you fine, Dita? You may have to go down. Go down to the midterm section. It should be further down, it looks like. And there should be two Adobe files. You found it? You got the in-class? Okay, cool. So pull up the in-class. There you go. And go to intrinsic valuation case study 3 under business investment banking. So what we're going to do is we're going to buy a tech company. Yeah. You find it?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you. All right. So this is the one we're going to do. All right. So if you can pull it up, you can follow through with me. So what I want to do is I'm going to do 3 case studies for the exam. One is we're going to buy a tech company. Second is we're going to build a $1 billion biotech facility in Mission Bay in San Francisco. And then the third one is we're going to value IBM, a tech company, an established tech company like IBM or Intel. Okay, so those will be the 3. And then on the final, I'll just have like four case studies like this. Okay, and you'll just work through the problem. So this is really the heart and soul of the class. It all kind of pulls together into this. So let me read this. As we know, and who's my timekeeper? How much time do I have?
30 minutes.
Okay, I think I can do it. As we know, there are 4 main valuation methods. For this case study, we are going to use, as we know, the 4 main valuation methods. For this case study, we are going to use earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization for the target company. So we're the acquirer, target, and the targeted company that we want to buy. The following are the case study assumptions. Models used, perpetuity, which can be used for the initial value or terminal values, or in growth, initial terminal, multiple approach. We have come up with a 12% expected return. We can calculate a multiple from that. And the discounted cash flow. Company that we're buying, so we're already a large company, so we're going to buy another large tech company. And this company is in hardware, software, cloud, mobile, global products and services sales. So it sounds like an IBM or something like that, but it's probably an emerging company. We also have assumptions that the free cash flow or the EBITDA in T=1 is $200 million. Zero. The free cash flow going in, growth rate is 5%, the terminal is 3%. The weighted average cost of capital can be calculated using the capital structure of 70% debt, 30% owner's equity, but I already give you the weighted average cost of capital, which is the going in is 22% and the terminal is 24%. The cash flows in the first year are 20%, 18% in the second, 15% in the third, 12% in the fourth, 6th to 5th, and then we need the 6 years to be able to get the 6 years cash flow to be able to calculate the terminal value. the target company is asking $4 billion, and the holding period is 5 years. So let's start figuring out the valuation. Okay, so what do we do first for the perpetuity model? What do we need? Calculate the value using perpetuity. We need cash flow. Do we use last year, this year, or next year's? Last year, this year, or next year's? Next year's. So what do we grow the this year's cash flow out by to get next year's? What is it? By how much? What?
1 more year?
Yeah, by how much? And again, you're all analysts. You're all investment banking analysts. You're all working for Oracle, Cisco, Intel, Salesforce, you name it. You could be working for any of these companies, going through exactly this exercise.
5%?
What is it?
5%?
5% is the going in, and that's too low. I wouldn't buy this company if I had cash flows for the first year of 5%. This is a tech company. So what's the growth rate in the cash flow? I need next year's.
20%.
What is it?
20%.
20%, so what's 200,000 times 1.2? 2. You can break out all your calculators and start calculating. Or do it on your phone, or do it on your do an Excel spreadsheet, or do it somewhere. What is it? So 240 million.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Because we're a big company. And then, so now that I got the next year's cash flow, what do I do with it to get the value? What do I do? Perpetuity model. What do I do? The assumptions are here. What's my expected rate of return? What's my hurdle rate? What's my WACC? What do I use? We're not going to get through it if you guys aren't throwing out numbers. I got like 20 analysts in here, and there should be no pause. Okay.
What's that discount?
What is it? What's the discount rate?
Discount rate's 1.2.
Yeah. What's my expected return? What's my WACC? What's my hurdle rate? What's my discount rate? What am I using to discount this cash flow to get the value? What's my expected return? What's my WACC?
0.4.
What's my WACC?
22.
22%. So what's 240 divided by 22? And we need to go quicker than this.
10.9.
What is it?
10.9.
10.9? No. Round up. Don't give you decimal.
It's well, 10.9.
Okay, you guys need to be calculating this stuff and giving me numbers. And making sure that I'm getting right numbers. So what is it?
1,090.
Okay, 1090. Okay, got it. Okay, valuation method done. Now, Gordon, grow. What do we do with that? Now, what do we do? With the Gordon growth, what do we do? What are we doing? Hurry. We're running out of time. What's the Gordon growth equation? What's the assumption?
Cash flows for the next year over
it's basically the expected return of the discount rate or the weighted average cost of capital. Got it. Now what do we do? Now what? I'm just going to keep asking questions. We have 22 analysts in here working on one project. What do we do now with the Gordon Growth model? What do we do with Gordon Growth? Go look up your, go to your exams, go online, Google it, do. You know, go to the book, go to the presentation. What do you do?
Cash flow is the power of T plus 1 over 1 minus G.
Okay, so what's missing in this equation?
The growth.
Got it. So what do we subtract the expected return by? I give it to you. It's all right here. Don't I give you a going-in free cash flow growth rate?
5%.
So what's 22 divided minus 0.05. What does that give you?
0.17.
So it's 240 million divided by 0.17. Calculators.
1,411.
Okay. Gordon Road, done. Let's do both of them. So what's the cash flow that we're using? What's next year's cash flow? What's the projected cash flow? We already calculated it. I'm just testing you to see if you're following along. What is it? 240? Okay. So 240 million. And then we're going to multiply that by some multiple. It's going to give the value. Did that give you some kind of indication of what the multiple would be that we could use? Did I say 12%? Can I calculate a multiple by doing 1 divided by 0.12? Can I do that? Can I calculate a multiple like that? Yep. So what's 1 divided by 0.12? What's the multiple? 8.3, so let's use 8 times. So what's 8 times 240? What is it?
1920 million.
Got it. Okay. Can I also create a multiple using the 0.22? Can I create a multiple using the 0.22? Yep. So what's 1 divided by 0.22? So 5 times. That's 5 times 240. 1200. Okay, so I got another. Can I also create a multiple by 1 divided by 0.17 using the Gordon growth model? Can I do that too? Okay, what's 1 divided by 0.17? What is it?
5.96.
So 6? So what's 6 times 240? What is it? 1440. Okay. And what's the seller trying to sell it to us for? How much?
1 billion.
What is it?
4 billion.
4 billion? So 4 billion divided by 240 million. What's the multiple he's trying to sell it to us at? What's his multiple? Or her multiple? What's the multiple they're assuming? Because we're totally off.
16.6,
so basically 17 times. Right? 17 times free cash flow. So if our multiple is 8 and theirs is 17, we're off. They're assuming higher growth rates. We're assuming higher growth rates in the free cash flow projections going forward. So there's a disconnect here. All right. What's the next model?
DCF.
DCF. Okay. So let's do DCF. And what are we trying to calculate using DCF? What are we trying to calculate? What is it?
First, don't you need terminal value?
No, let's not go there yet. What are we trying to calculate using the discounted cash flow model? Present value. Okay, nice job. Present value. And then what's the holding period? Years. Got it. And then what's our expected return or hurdle rate or discount rate or WACC that we're going to use? What is it? What's our expected return or discount rate or WACC? They're all basically the same thing. 22%. So 1.22, can you guys start doing the math for me? So we can do this. So 1.22, 3, 1.22, 4, and 1.225. Okay, can you give me the discount factors? I know that one. What's this one? What's 1.22 squared?
1.48.
1.48. And everybody should be doing these calculations. What's 1.22 cubed?
1.82.
What's 1.22 to the 4th power?
2.22.
And what's 1.22 to the 5th power?
2.7.
Okay, so now I got the discount factors. So what's the cash flow in the first year? What's the cash flow that we used in the first year? And that's this year. What's the cash flow for forecasted for next year? 240. Got it. Okay. 240 million. Got it. Okay. And then what do we do? Now what do we do? Am I just going to use 240 every single year, or did I come up with some other kind of projections? Did I come up with any projections?
18%.
18, exactly. So what's 1.18 times 240?
283.2.
283, yeah, just round up. Because the decimal point's driving crazy. Okay, and then what do we do now? 1.15. So it's 283 times 1.15.
325.
325. Excellent. Okay. And then what do we do now?
325 times 1.15.
Yep, times 12%. So we're going to round it up 12. So what's 325 times 1.12? What is it? 364. Now, is everybody checking these numbers? Because one time I did this and they were wrong. And I had to go back and redo everything, and I'll tell you, if you guys feed me wrong numbers and I'm in a meeting, I'm fired, right? If I present to the investment committee this, I'm fired. You're gonna get fired, I'm not coming back, okay? So it's gotta be really accurate, and you need to check the numbers. Because we're talking about billions of dollars. Okay, what do we do now? 1.06, got it. So what's 364 times, what do you got?
386.
Excellent. Okay. Now what do we do? Do we?
Oh, yeah. Two divided.
Okay, I could. I'm going to get the present value, but I forgot something. What do we need to calculate?
Six.
What do we need to calculate?
The next year?
We do. What's it going to give us? Why are we going to do that? What are we going to get out of that exercise? What?
Terminal.
The terminal value. So we got to come up with the terminal value. So we got to grow this out one more year. What do we grow it out by? 1.03. So it's 386 million times 1.03.
398.
398 million. Got it. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, awesome. All right, so now we got the cash flow for basically the sixth period. Now the question is, are we going to use the going-in discount rate, or are we going to use the terminal discount rate? Terminal. Can we project what the market's going to be like and what the future environment's going to be like in 6 years from now and beyond? Can I forecast years 4 and 5 and 6 and into infinity? Can I project those for 100% certainty? No. So am I going to want to adjust the discount rate up to reflect more risk in the future?
Yeah.
And usually you add about 200 basis points onto the going in. So what does that mean? What do we use then as the discount rate? The terminal discount rate. If I add 200 basis points onto the going in discount rate, what do we get? What is it?
2.22.
Nope. I'm using 2.22 as the going in. I need to add on 200 basis points to add on some additional risk, because I can't forecast out into the future.
4.2.
So I'm using 200 basis points, and I'm using
4.2.
Oh, 0.24, and I already give it to you. Right? It's already there. But the theory is that you need to factor in additional risk into the future, and the terminal discount rate cannot be equal to or below the going in, because there's more risk in the future. Okay. And then what about, are we going to assume that the cash flows are going to be flat forever or grow at a constant rate? What kind of company is this? It's a tech company. Do their
they grow.
Okay, so we're going to use one more. So what's the terminal growth rate that we're going to use? What do we assume? Terminal G. 3%. So minus 0.03 is going to give us what? 0.21. And what's 398 million divided by 0.21? Give me the terminal value. $1,895 million. Is that right?
Yes.
Is that right? Yep, okay. And then what do we do with that? What do we do with the terminal value? Now what do we do with that? Because it's sitting out here in year six. We gotta do something with it. Do I discount that by 1 point, by 1.0, by 1.22 to the six? I could do that. I could do that. Okay? But what I'm probably gonna do is I'm gonna add the terminal value to the last year's cash flows. Okay? And what does that give me? What does that give me? What's 1895 plus 386?
2281.
2281. So this is going to give me the cash flow that I'm going to receive in the last year of the holding period. So what's 2281 divided by 2.7, which is the discount factor?
846.
846 million. And then what's 364 divided by 2.22?
164.
And what's 325 divided by 182?
179
million. Got it. And then what's 283 divided by 148? 191. And what's 240 divided by 1.22?
197.
Is everybody following along? Are you correct? Checking these things and making sure they're correct? Are they correct? Are you checking? Thank you. All right, so what's 197 plus 191 plus 179 plus 164 plus 846? What is it? 1577, right? All right. I think we have a problem, don't we? Because I'm getting 1577 and they're asking for 2 billion. So what's my net present value? What's my NPV? What's my net present value? I'm getting a present value of the cash flows, 1.6 billion, and they're asking for. So what's my net present value? What is it? What's my net present value? Is my net present value positive or negative?
Negative.
Negative. You know that. By how much?
423.
How much?
423.
Is that right? 423 billion? Oh no, sorry. I got it wrong. It's 4 billion. Okay. Selling price is 4 billion, not 2 billion. So what is my net negative net present value now? Sorry about that.
It's
2,423. Okay. Are we off? Yeah, we're screwed. Because they're assuming a significantly higher multiple. They think free cash flows are going to grow even faster than we do. So we're off. Okay. So do we accept or reject here?
Reject.
We're going to reject it. Okay. But I hate to say it, we want this project. We want this company. We really want this company. Okay. So what's the first thing that we can do? What's the first thing we can do if we really want this company? Let's wait on that. What's the very first thing we can do? What's the first thing we would do? Okay, we'd ask for a price reduction. Okay, ask for, in what amount? In what amount would we ask for a price reduction? In what amount? To get the net present value equal to zero.
$2,423 million.
$2,423 million. So the first thing you would do is go back to the seller and ask for a price reduction. In the amount of the net present value. And if I can get a price reduction in the amount of the net present value, my net present value turns to zero and I accept the project. We're in. Bad news. They won't do it. These guys have internal knowledge about the company. They think the multiple's a lot higher. They think the cash flow projections are significantly higher on the growth rates. They're not willing to budge on the $4 million. So now what do we do? We really want this company. Now what do? We got a second chance. We actually have three chances. But what do we do now? What do we do now? Do we do something else, or do we just throw in the towel? You don't get your bonuses because you rejected the project. And everybody on the investment committee and the board wants this company. So you're going to go to the board and you're going to tell them, sorry, we can't buy this project because we have a negative net present value. But the board's saying we really want it. What's the board going to tell you to do?
Figure out a way to get it.
What?
Figure out a way to get it.
Figure out a way to get it. How would you do it?
First year's cash flow and block.
Yeah, what I would probably do is go back and reevaluate the first year cash flow. Maybe I underestimated the growth rate when we take over the company. So the first thing I would look at is the level of the first year cash flow. Because everything falls off that, right? What else would I look at? Again, I'm trying to get you to start thinking like business people. So what would you do now? What else would you look at? First year cash flow would be the first. Growth rate. First year, maybe we underestimate that too. What else?
Discount rate?
Yeah. Did we over or underestimate the discount rate?
Over.
We probably overestimated it, right? So if we overestimated this, our net present value, our present value, internal rate of return is going to be lower. If we lower our expectations, or we go back and we recalculate the WACC or the discount rate, and we can get it lower, what's going to happen to the present value, the net present value, and the internal rate of return if we lower the discount rate? It's going to go up. Okay? So we would go back and reevaluate the expected return, discount rate, and the WACC. Okay, what else can we look at? What other factors in the law?
Can you calculate the present value of the future cash flows?
Okay, so tell me more about the future cash flow. What else could we look at? What did we do to the cash flows? We did what?
Well, we looked at the growth rate.
Yeah.
Into it.
Right. Did we underestimate the growth rate? Maybe our team, our management team, could actually grow the revenues faster. Free cash was faster in the first 3 years. So we totally underestimated the growth rates. If we increase the growth rates, what's going to happen to the present value, net present value, and internal rate of return? It's going to go up. Okay. What other factors in the model can we reevaluate? Again, just walk through the process. What do we miss here? It's a puzzle. Holding period theoretically really doesn't have an impact on the PV. Because the terminal value corrects for all that. Okay. So what other variables, what other factors could be an influence on the PV, MPV, and IRR? Walk through the model. You're missing out a couple variables. What did we do? Discount the cash flow, grew them out. What do we do after we grew them out? We're missing something. Come on, I only got like 5 minutes.
It's not the expected return.
No, we already did that with
the discount change.
Yeah. So what are we missing? We calculated something that has a major impact on the present value of the net present value.
Terminal value now?
Terminal value, okay. So did we overestimate the terminal value? Did we over underestimate the terminal value?
We underestimated it,
okay. So if we underestimated it, where did the underestimation come from? So did we over or underestimate the terminal discount rate? We overestimated that. Do we over underestimate the growth rate? We what?
Underestimated.
We underestimated. so maybe we can lower that and increase that, increase that. And if we increase the terminal value, we increase the present value, net present value, and internal rate of return. Okay? So I got bad news for you. We went back, you all went back, audited everything, audited the financial statements, audited them, the model, and it's right. Okay, it's correct. Alright. But we want this company. Alright, we want this company. You got one more shot. You got one more iteration that you can go through. And it is used a lot in biotech companies and their corporate finance departments and stuff. You calculate what is called a real call option. Okay. Real call option value. You gotta calculate the real call option value. Because there's other intrinsic values, there's other intrinsics to this company that's not being taken into consideration in traditional investment decision making tools in DCI. And there's two models, I'm not going to go through it. Black-Scholes and binomial tree. These are three mathematical equations that you would use to be able to derive the real call option value. The real call option value is determined by four factors. First is time. These are long-term assets, right? Very long dated, okay? So it's just like the call option that's in your chapter 20. It's the same model that basically states you pay some premium, you have exercise price, you have value, and if the valuation of the firm goes through the roof, you're going to be in the money. And the premium that you pay is actually going to be negative NPV. So we can modify the call option models for a real call option. So time adds value. So time value is a huge component because these are long dated contracts. The other is valuation volatility. Do tech company valuations move a lot? Yeah, they do. So we could spike into the in the money on the this real call option if the revenues just hockey stick and go vertical. Okay. The other is management decision. So can the management add value through this process? Once we get in and take over the company, could we like add more value than we actually thought? Yep. And then do we also have a decision to be able to sell the company at some point in time in the future? At the optimal time period? Yeah. So that adds value to the real call option too. So the problem is that we have a negative net present value of how much? $2,423,000. Okay. And to be able to get to the net present value, we can make an investment decision. What's the value of the roll call option going to be?
Higher than.
What?
Higher than.
Or?
Equal to.
Equal. 2,423. So if the real call option is equal, the value is equal to $2,423,000,000, what's our net present value?
Zero.
Do we accept or reject it?
Accept.
Okay. And if the real call option is less than the negative net present value, what are we going to do? We're going to reject it. And if the real call option value is greater than the negative net present value, then our net present value is going to be positive, and we're going to do the deal. Okay. That's it. We'll go through this a bunch of times. Okay. But this is the methodology. It kind of has a very high level that kind of swirls in these people's brains. And then you really delve into the cash flow statements. But this is methodological. If you get this, you feel comfortable with it, it's real world. The tricky part is this terminal value, throwing it out and having it back. statement. Okay? So you guys are all, everybody's doing a great job.